back to another edition of the Prepper Recon Podcast. Our mission is to bring you great interviews with preppers from around the world so you can be better informed and better prepared for everything from a hurricane to the end of the world as we know it. This episode is brought to you by CampingSurvival.com. Whether your plan is to bug out or bug in, CampingSurvival.com has all of your preparedness needs, including bug-out bags, long-term storage food, water filters, gas mask, and first aid kits. Check them out online today at CampingSurvival.com. Be sure to enter coupon code PREPPERRECON for a 5% discount on your entire order. Today's guest is Josh Collier of BeatTheEnd.com. Josh, thanks for coming back on the show. It's been a while.
Yeah, thanks for having me again. It's always a good interview.
Yeah, we always have a good time when you're on.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a little bit of different approach to prepping to bug out. You actually configured your truck as a bug out truck.
I think we had talked about this a little bit originally the first time I had come on the show. Basically, say 2002 Chevy 2500 HD. It is the 6 liter gas, not the diesel. But I have a truck shell or bed cap on there. And basically, I have it set up with a sleeping arrangement that I've made. It was actually in the truck, but I've redone the whole thing, made it a lot more usable. But what it is, basically, is made from plywood and some small pieces of wood. And it has sides on it. It's two sides. Basically, looks like you could sit down on it, kind of like military trucks. And each of those have places you can put stuff in. Just open it up. It's basically a little cabinet, and they have on top they have 3-inch foam with carpet, automotive carpet, and they're put in such a way that there's also a middle parts to it. You can put those right on top of it, across the center of it, to make a bed. So at any point in time, if I'm stuck in a blizzard, whatever it is, I can put it on there, have a very comfortable bed. I've slept in it quite a bit. I have an excess amount of blankets and sleeping bags in there. It's actually quite comfortable. It's much better than having a tent. And it has basically everything I need in it. I can store stuff underneath the bed area. I usually store water, usually a 5 gallon water bucket. One of the main things with the 5 gallons, if you decide to do something like this, if you get those cheap ones at Walmart, the green or blue ones, they're usually about $10. But if you put them down, right now I have to sit it down with water, they do leak quite a bit. So getting those military style, there's a military style water holder. It's about a 5 or 6 gallon, and they're usually about $40 or so from a military surplus. Those are some of the best water holders, and cool. I definitely use one of those.
You got about 6 gallons of gas in there right now?
What's that?
You got about 6 gallons of water in there right now?
Oh, yeah, 6 gallons. I have that, and then I have a small one that I can actually put in the sides in the little cabinets. So that's another gallon. And then actually in the truck I usually keep, I have the Walmart waters or Sam's Club waters. They have like a 40-pack of the bottled water. So I have a decent amount of water just in the truck. I could probably live, I don't know, a couple weeks.
Cool. And then you've got some purification method in there as well.
Right. I have a... so I keep that water in there, but I also have a water purifier, the MSR water purifier, MiniWorks EX water purifier, and that works extremely well, so I can refill if I need to. I've used that out camping and never had problems. You can basically put that in muck and it'll still filter through.
Well, that's awesome.
So, if I do run out of that let's say I had to be out for a couple weeks, I may run out of water. But then at that point, I could hopefully be around water or a spring or something like that.
And you said it's better than a tent. I guess it is, especially if a bear gets after you. It's going to be a lot harder for a bear to get through a truck than a tent, huh?
Yeah, that's 10 times better. There are some kind I've seen called the, I can't remember what it is, but basically they pop up the top on top of the truck and they have a tent up top, but you still have some wind coming across. And yeah, if a bear wanted to climb up there, he could. So this way don't see any way that a bear is going to get in. I mean, there are windows, so you can close the windows. It stays probably about 20 or so degrees cooler, and it's a small area, so you can't really sit up too much, but your body heat really heats that whole area. So
cool.
So it keeps me extremely warm with all the blankets I have.
How far can you go in a tank of gas?
Not far enough. That's one of the other things I've looked at. One of the bummers is it's not a diesel. I've always wanted a diesel, but just didn't have the money. So, I don't know, probably 300 miles is the range, which still isn't enough. To get where I would want to bug out if I had to, it is enough, and I still have an amount left over.
Cool. But do you keep extra gas in the truck?
I do have like another 5 gallon. Gas tank. I don't too often carry it, but I do have it at the house. One of the things I have been wanting is one of the metal ones that has a pump on it to hold another 20 or so gallons.
Ones you see in the military where they've got them strapped onto the front of the Jeep? Is that what you're talking about?
No, actually the ones that go in the bed. There's some that go inside.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, the big metal ones. Haven't done anything there yet, but just some things I wanted to do. I also, right now I use an inverter at this point to power anything I need to in there. I'm looking to, in one of the storage spaces, I'm wanting to do a solid state battery or solid cell, like a gel cell, something like that. Heavy duty battery, and the reason for that is basically that I could have electricity and not run it off of the battery that keeps the car going. And I also have seen some small panels, solar panels that I've looked at to put on top of the truck, or at least keep with me to keep that battery going. And keep it on an inverter. I do have an inverter at the moment that I use with that. And then I'll probably at that point put in plug-ins, outlets on the actual sleeping platform.
But now, before you get the solar panels, you could theoretically still take that solid-state battery and hook it up to your terminals on the alternator and recharge it from the truck. Is that right?
Right. Yeah, I've looked into that too. That you have a switch, basically a switch on it. Some are automatic switching that actually run off your battery until it's going low or something. Or, you can run it straight off the battery. The problem with running it straight off the battery is then you'll pull down both batteries. So you do want a switch of some sort in there, and then it will be charged and by the vehicle when you're actually running.
Very cool. And how much food do you store in a truck?
I try to. At the moment, I don't have it in my vehicle, but I try to store a lot of like rice-a-roni, stuff like that. At the moment, it's not even as much as a bug-out truck as it is if I need to. If I need to stay overnight, I'm stranded, something like that. So I store probably 5 or 6 days worth of food in it, which is more like, yeah, rice-a-roni, stuff like that.
Yeah, easy stuff. Still a lot more than what most people would have in their bug-out bag if they're only prepared for 72 hours, so you'd still almost double that.
Right, yeah, it's really easy to put some beef jerky in there, and there's a ton of storage in there that you can't even see it or anything. And then I also have a radio in there, like a weather radio, that can be charged by either solar, or it has a hand crank on it, which can also charge my phone. So I have a few things in there that would make living out there easier.
Yeah, those are cool, and a weather radio is a good thing to have around, because if there's some other type of disaster, they'll usually broadcast information about that disaster on the weather bands.
Right.
You know,
even if
it's a chemical spill from a train derailment or a earthquake or whatever.
Yeah,
they'll use that band to disseminate that information if they need it.
Yep, it's definitely a nice thing to have. The only problem I see with how I have it set up is, like right now, I was telling you earlier before the podcast, that right now we did just buy a house, so we're getting a lot of big stuff, and it's the only truck we have. Right. So I do have it out of the truck right now, so it doesn't help me that much.
Right.
So basically, that's probably the biggest problem I see. I mean, I am close to work that I'm probably going to be able to get home to get it going. But, yeah, it's definitely good for get home and, bug out.
Very cool. Now, have you got some, first aid equipment in there?
Yeah, I also got a small plastic first aid kit. I think it's one of the, like, 400. I don't have a big medical kit yet, so still waiting for that.
Yeah, mine keeps building, and it's the one in my bug out bag is getting really, really big. I don't know.
Yeah, we're hoping here in the next couple months to take a first aid class. It's called Independence Training. We did our concealed weapons permit with them, but they do wilderness classes and stuff. And they have it's called IFAC. It's a big class they do for the first aid, because I think that's probably just as important. The first aid is just as important, or sometimes even more than the concealed weapons classes and stuff. So,
oh heck yeah! Because if you're in an active shooter situation, even if you're just hiding out, or whether you're trying to engage the guy or whatever, there's a real good chance of you or somebody else getting shot. And you know, maybe just knowing a few little things to address trauma might save somebody's life, and the life you save might be yours.
Yeah, and these guys actually do, I really like him because he's a prepper too, and they do what's that IFAC class he calls dirt medicine, which is if you get shot, you're going to have to keep the wound from bleeding out, and it's basically how to get a wound and correctly treat it.
Mm-hmm.
So we're hoping to do that, and at that point we'll probably get the bigger kit. They do offer a bigger kit with that, so.
Yeah, I've got a couple of those Israeli battle dressings, which are just a little Ziploc. Well, it's a pressure-sealed container, and you rip it open, and it's got like a big trauma bandage in there with a thing that would be similar to like an ACE bandage, where it's just real easy to just put something on a big wound and seal it up really quick. And I'm going to get a couple more of those, one to keep in the car and one to keep in the other bug-out bag, and just an extra one to have.
So yeah,
really good things for...
He was telling me those are some of the best to have, those Israeli ones. Mm-hmm. He also said one of the best things to keep with you when out hunting or something is tampons.
Yeah.
He said those are great for medical purposes.
Great for a gunshot wound.
Right, just put it in there, and you basically got something to keep pushing through. So
that's for sure. Where are you planning to bug out if you ever had to leave your area because of?
We don't have an actual home or anything, other second home or anything. One of the areas that I hunt and know quite well is one of the places I'd probably go. It's up on a hill. Or it's basically up on a huge mesa. Not much around it. There's quite a bit of water. There's actually a canyon on one side. And it's just a great place where I know real well. And I know there's a ton of elk there. So stuff to eat. And then water in a small river down there.
And then you were telling us about the sleeping area that you built out. Have you got What do you have on there for cushion? Just a lot of blankets, or do you have like?
No, the cushion actually, it's basically you got the plywood, uh-huh. and then over top of that you got 3-inch styrofoam. So the 3-inch styrofoam is just as good as sleeping on a futon.
Oh, very cool.
It's not the most comfortable thing, but we went camping and I slept on the ground. I was like, this is 10 times better than sleeping on the ground. And it's much, no bugs in there, you know, that's a big thing is bugs and the cold, so.
No bugs, no bears. Well,
no bear.
Depends on the size of the bear, I guess. You get the right size bear, I guess he can get in anything, huh?
Yeah, you get a big bear to get in.
No. So speaking of bears, what about security? Do you keep a firearm in the truck?
That I haven't yet, cause I'm trying to still figure out what I do. I mean, it's secure where I have locks on both of them, but anybody that wants to get in can. So we're still looking for a good small pistol. I do have one pistol I use, a 357 mag, which we sometimes keep in the vehicle. Usually not in the back, because it is where it's not easy to get in. It can be gotten into a lot easier than the front of the truck.
But since you've got so many of your other supplies already in the truck, you already got water, a little bit of food, and your basic shelter and everything else like that, you've probably got plenty of time to grab a firearm or some ammo or whatever you need.
Yeah, I mean, I always keep
one by the bed. As you're running out the door.
Right, I keep one by the bed, and I'm always, anytime I go hunting and or out in the wilderness, it's there with me. So that would definitely be what I'd bring. It's the 357 mag and probably my AR-15. So
yeah, and you guys always have a lot of good giveaways over at beattheend.com. One time you had a little Sentry alarm that you guys were giving away, and it was basically
right.
like a sort of a tripwire alarm that used the 22 caliber nail gun loads.
Right.
Would that be a good thing to, do you keep any of those to set up a perimeter alarm in case you have to bug out with your truck? Do you keep that stuff in your truck?
I haven't. It definitely would be good. You know, the actual guy that was doing that is no longer in business, but it is something you could make by yourself. And I've seen some other versions of it. But that would be a good thing to have, mounted on the inside, when you're sleeping. I mean, you're probably going to hear someone. Or, right, a small perimeter, you can make with just a small trip wire. It's real easy to wire up a trip wire and a couple of those. And they seem to work really well, and you can get the 22 RAM sets anywhere pretty much.
Yeah, I saw one, that some guy had made on YouTube, and it looked like it was pretty easy to make. He just made it out of a mouse trap. He just basically had like a little flange with a roofing nail shortened, and that just sat right over the primer, and when the trap snapped, it would strike that nail and strike the primer. And I was thinking about making one, and you could actually make it with, I don't know if you know a lot about black powder, but they have these little percussion caps, which are fairly loud, but they're really cheap. You get a whole big can of like 100 of them, and it's really small. It doesn't take up much room, and they're pretty cheap, and they're loud. It's like a firecracker loud.
Right. I do have a black powder rifle, and they are loud enough that you would be able to hear them in a truck if it was pretty close. So something like that is a good idea and probably pretty easy and cheap to make.
Yeah, I think I'm actually going to try to make some of those, so I'll probably have a video or something of it on my site pretty soon. And now, for another thing that's a good for security, you just got a new dog.
Yeah, probably not the best. He's not a mauler or anything, but he is definitely a barker. He's a red-boned coonhound, mm-hmm. so he's going to bark at anything that comes around.
Yeah, well, a coonhound will probably put a bite on somebody, though, if they try to come in the door.
Yeah, if he came in, someone came in and were trying to get something like that, yeah, he probably would. He's kind of territorial. So, but yeah, he's a most friendly dog, but he is definitely a bit territorial when we've had other dogs in here and stuff. So.
But I mean, even if you got a Chihuahua, he's gonna wake you up so you can get the shotgun. You know?
Right. That's the main thing.
That's really all you need him for, is to wake you up.
Right. Right. Yeah, as long as you got something there to make noise when someone's close. There's also, if you read that book, he was on your website, Nathan Hill. Yes,
Nathan Hill Jefferson. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I need to do a review on his book too. It's a really good book. But he had in there, they basically were using cans as a perimeter device.
Yeah, that's right. That was in
rocks, I think, or something in them.
Yeah, they had cans with rocks, and then just had that on fishing line or something like that, and you'd bump the fishing line, and it would rattle the cans around against each other.
Yeah, and would come off the fence or something.
Yeah, that was a really, really good tip. That book's called The Wayward Journey, and the author's name was Nathan Hale Jefferson. I've still got a link on it on the site of PrepperRecon.com to purchase that through Amazon. It was a great book. I really liked reading that.
Yeah, it was fun. It wasn't as technical as the guy on Survival Blog, Rawls' book.
James Rawls.
It wasn't as technical, but it was definitely more fun.
Yeah.
And definitely had some points in it and some techniques and stuff that were good. And he has a second one coming out, too, which he told me about. So.
Yeah, looking forward to that. And I am a big James Rawls fan, though. It is a little technical, but I love reading his books. And his new book is Expatriates is coming out in October. And so that should really be a good one.
Cool.
And then you're going to send us some pictures when you're putting your truck back together. And then we're going to put them up on the website with this post. And then we'll also use those when we replicate our shows to YouTube. We'll always have a little slideshow there. So we'll also have those on the YouTube. So for everybody out there listening that's listening on Stitcher, or if you subscribe to us on iTunes, you might not be seeing the picture. So make sure you head over to PrepperRecon.com and check out the homepage for the podcast, and you'll see all the pictures of how Josh has configured his truck. Josh, thanks again for coming back on the show.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
And then before you go, let the folks know where they can find you.
You can find me at www.beattheend.com. We do have a giveaway going on right now, too. Basically, the food, fire, and filter bucket. It's a 72-hour survival bucket, which would be definitely a great thing to put in your vehicle. Water filter, ways to make fire, and then 72 hours worth of food.
Yeah, you guys always have great giveaways going on over there. So, I mean, even if it's somebody that's listening to this show and it's an older show or whatever, still go over and check out beattheend.com, because Josh has always got something new going on over there.
Yep, I appreciate it.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to another edition of the Prepper Recon podcast. If you're new to prepping and you want to learn more, you can check out our 7-step survival plan. It's under the category section on the left-hand side of the page. Until next time, happy prepping.